Hey everyone, it's Sarah with RegisteredNurseRN.com, and today we're going to continue our series on pharmacology by talking about the drug Warfarin, also called Coumadin. And when you get done watching this YouTube video, don't forget to access the free quiz that will test you on this medication. So let's get started. As we've been studying these medications in this series, we've been remembering the word nurse because this helps remind us of those important questions that we need to ask ourselves whenever we're studying these medications for exams. So you want to ask yourself the name, specifically the family name of this drug, because that's going to tell you how this drug works. You want to ask yourself, what's it used for? Why are we even giving this medication to this patient? What is it treating? And then R for responsibilities as a nurse, what's our role? What are we going to be doing for this patient who's taking this particular medication? Then S for side effects, and then E for education for the patient. What are those education pieces we're going to be providing to this patient who is taking this drug? And NCLEX really loves to ask about the responsibilities and the education. So really concentrate on those two parts whenever you're studying these medications. So first, let's talk about the name. We're dealing with the drug Warfarin, also called Coumadin. And this drug is part of the family of the vitamin K antagonists. Now, to understand how this drug really works, we need to understand the role of vitamin K in our body. Vitamin K is used to make clotting factors in the liver. And there's these specific clotting factors that depend on vitamin K in order to work properly. So if we throw on a vitamin K antagonist, what does the word antagonist mean? Well, let's look at the prefix, A-N-T. That means it works against. So it works against what vitamin K normally would do in the body to influence these clotting factors. So it's going to work against the clotting process. It's going to slow down that patient's ability to actually form a clot, which makes it an anticoagulant. And there's various types of anticoagulants that we're going to cover in this series. So anticoagulants, what they do is they really alter that coagulation process where the blood, where it's normally in that liquid state, will go to that semi/solid state where that clot forms. So it's going to help prevent blood clots from forming. Or it can help treat blood clots. Like if you already have a blood clot in the body, it can prevent it from getting bigger, because when they get bigger, they can break off and they can travel into circulation. So it prevents venous thromboembolisms, VTEs. And a VTE will start out as a clot in the vein. This is where we call this a deep vein thrombosis, a DVT. The problem with a DVT is that it can break off and go into circulation. We refer to this, whenever this happens, as an embolism, and this clot can travel through the body and end up in the lungs, where it'll be a pulmonary embolism, a PE, or the clot can travel to the brain and block circulation to the brain, cause a stroke, or to the heart and block circulation to the heart muscle. Now, how does warfarin actually work as an anticoagulant? What clotting factors does it affect? Well, we've already established that it stops the clotting process by blocking the formation of those clotting factors that require vitamin K. But what are those clotting factors? And I would remember these factors. They are clotting factors 2, 7, 9, and 10. And another important thing that you want to remember for yourself as the nurse and to educate your patient, because they may wonder exactly how this drug works, is that warfarin does not dissolve or break up an existing clot. What it's going to do is it's going to prolong how long it takes the blood to actually form a clot. Now let's talk about what warfarin is used for. It's used for long-term anticoagulation. So it's going to help prevent or treat blood clots. Like when a patient has a deep vein thrombosis, they have a pulmonary embolism, they'll be on Coumadin. And some things you want to remember as a nurse whenever you're looking at your patients that you're caring for, you want to be thinking of conditions that would actually increase a patient's risk of developing a blood clot. So patients who are post-op from surgery, especially with hip or knee, they're at risk for developing a blood clot. They're in atrial fibrillation because the heart really isn't emptying very well. The blood's pooling in there. They can throw a clot. if they've had a heart valve replacement or a myocardial infarction. Now let's talk about the responsibilities of the nurse in a patient who is taking this medication. So anytime you see the word Coumadin or Warfarin, you automatically want PT-INR to jump into your head. It's very important, not only for your exams, but whenever you're working on the floor and your patient has a dose of Warfarin due. You need to look at their INR level before you even give that medication, because this drug works in a very narrow therapeutic range. We want them within this certain range, because if they fall too low, that means the drug's not really effective and they're at risk for blood clots. If they're too high, they're at risk for bleeding, and we'd want to monitor them for that. So, to do that, we monitor a PT-INR level. So let's talk about that. What's a PT level? PT stands for prothrombin time. Prothrombin is a clotting factor. So by monitoring this, it's measured in seconds. It's telling us how fast a clot forms, really how fast prothrombin turns into thrombin. A normal PT in a person who's not like taking Warfarin or anything should be anywhere between 10 to 12 seconds. Now this normal value varies among labs, what they deem as normal, which is why we care really more about what our INR level is. This INR is calculated from the PT. INR stands for International Normalized Ratio, and by reporting this in the INR, it creates the standardized system of reporting these value ranges for this Warfarin, because as I said, the PT range, it can vary among labs. So we've standardized it here. So your INR is calculated from your PT. A normal INR in someone who's not taking Warfarin, or if they are, that means that they're not therapeutic, would be 0.75 to 1.25. Now, the therapeutic range that we want a patient in when they're taking Warfarin for it to be effective for them, and I would remember this number, commit it to memory, is 2 to 3. That is that range we want them. Now, it may be slightly higher in some patients who are at a higher risk of developing a blood clot, sometimes up to 4.5, but it's whatever the physician has deemed for that patient for their therapeutic range to be. So remember this number. Now, test questions like to throw out an INR at you and ask you, what is your next nursing action? So let's say the INR is 6 and they have a dose of Coumadin. What are you going to do? The answer would be you would hold that dose and you would notify the physician. And some other questions could stem from, like, you know, the INR is low and it would be less than 2. That would mean that they're not therapeutic. What are they at risk for? They're at risk for clots, and they would need their dosage increased. How about their INR was high? Well, they're at risk for bleeding, so you'd want to monitor them for that, and their dose needs to be lowered. Now let's discuss some indications that your patient may be bleeding from this Warfarin, and it's usually in the most unusual places that they will be having this bleeding. So you want to be looking at those gums. Are they having oozing around their gums? Dark tarry stools, we refer to this as melena. This could indicate there's blood in the stool, and you'd want to check that and see if they test for a positive occult stool. Are they having any blood in their urine? Look at their urine. Is it reddish pink? They're leaking blood in there. Nosebleeds, having all these nosebleeds all of a sudden. Vomiting blood. The emesis looks like coffee grounds. That could indicate blood. Are they experiencing bruising for no reason, bleeding under the skin? And looking at their vitals, if they have high heart rate, they're tachycardic, and their blood pressure is really low, hypotensive, that could indicate that you have some internal bleeding somewhere that you cannot see. And do they complain of a sudden severe headache where they have bleeding in the brain? So look out for those. Now, Warfarin is not for patients who are going to have an increased risk of bleeding, because they can die. So it's not going to be for a patient who has active bleeding, like with an open wound, or they have active ulcer disease where those ulcers can just bleed, or they've had surgery that is spinal, eye, or brain surgery, or they have renal or liver failure, because this drug cannot be cleared and it can increase in the blood, increasing the INR level really high, and they're at risk for this bleeding. Another thing you want to remember is the antidote. Always remember antidotes whenever you're studying these drugs. The antidote for warfarin is vitamin K. Very easy to remember because we know it's a vitamin K antagonist. Some other takeaways is that you want to give this medication at the same time every day. It's usually in the evenings, towards the end of your shift, on day shift. Whenever you're administering this warfarin medication, it's given in a pill and it's oral. The pills come in different colors depending on the dosage. And a lot of times, because it takes this drug about 3 to 5 days to get that INR level within that therapeutic range, the patient may be on heparin to help keep their blood thin until that Coumadin has taken over and then the heparin will be discontinued. And you want to avoid giving any type of intramuscular IM injections while your patient is taking this medication because, remember, they're at risk for bleeding. So pick a different route. Now let's talk about the side effects and the education pieces for the patient. Some other side effects that the patient could have are like GI related, like nausea, abdominal cramping, bloating, and they can bruise really easy. Some education pieces you want to provide to your patient on warfarin are those signs and symptoms of bleeding. Tell them to check their gums regularly, look at their urine, look at their stool, and report anything that looks suspicious to their doctor. Some other education pieces about using a toothbrush. They want to use a soft bristle toothbrush, not to damage the gums, not a hard bristle, because we don't want to get them bleeding. They want to use electric razors rather than just the straight razor to prevent getting cut. They want to avoid contact sports because, again, their blood is just really thin and they can experience some type of internal severe bleeding. They want to avoid over-the-counter medications, to always consult with their physician before they decide to take something over-the-counter that they don't need a prescription for, because warfarin interacts with a lot of medications, especially NSAIDs, aspirin, and those over-the-counter health supplements. Let the patient know that taking this drug is going to require them to get their INRPT level checked regularly because we need to make sure that this level is within therapeutic range. Also, we want to monitor their CBC, their complete blood count, along with their renal and liver function. If they injure themselves, cut themselves, have blood drawn, anything like that, they need to make sure that they hold direct firm pressure on that site because it's going to take a lot longer for them to clot. A lot of patients are surprised how much that site will just keep bleeding until they hold pressure. They need to avoid all alcoholic beverages because alcohol interferes with warfarin. They need to follow a regular diet, but avoid consuming excessive amounts of green leafy vegetables because this affects warfarin, such as lettuce, broccoli, greens, collard greens, kale, or spinach. Now, how about if your patient misses a dose? You want to talk to them about this because this medication has to be taken every day at the same exact time. What do they do if they miss a dose? Well, if they miss it, they will take when they remember if it's on the same day. So it's the same day when that dose was due, they remembered it, go ahead and take it. But let's say it's the next day, and then they just remember. They will skip that previous day's dose and just take the scheduled dose that's due that particular day. So they never want to take extra double dose or whatever, and write down that day when it happened and let the physician know. Okay, so that wraps up this review over warfarin. Thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to take the free quiz and to subscribe to our channel for more videos.